welcome tonight. I'm delighted at our turnout, and I think you're going to have a wonderful evening. The Lakeland Management Lecture Series has been running continuously for 35 years. It's the longest running lecture program at Lakeland, and I'd be hard-pressed to find any other special program that has been around as long as this program. We have had many wonderful top executives of local and national organizations speak here at Lakeland, and tonight is no exception. Our speaker tonight is Dr. Deborah Gribbon. She is the interim director of the Cleveland Museum of Art. The Cleveland Museum of Art's collection includes more than 46,000 works of art from all times and places. Their website says their works are from ancient Egypt and ancient Greece and Rome, all the way to contemporary and modern works of art. They have a staff of 339 employees, and when their renovation is completed in 2013, the museum will be 588,000 square feet, which has 89,000 of it will be galleries. Dr. Gribbon joined the Museum of Art when Director Timothy Rubb resigned to join the Philadelphia Museum of Art. She's been interim director since September 2009 and has been instrumental in helping the Museum of Art continue its $350 million expansion. Dr. Gribbon received her Bachelor of Arts in Art History from Wellesley College and her Master of Arts and PhD in Fine Arts from Harvard University. She began her career in Boston as the first curator of the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. And in 1984, she moved to Los Angeles in order to join the staff of the J. Paul Getty Museum, where she had worked for 20 years, first as chief curator, and then as deputy director, and finally as director of the museum and vice president of the J. Paul Getty Trust from 2000 to 2004. She's married to Winston Alt, an art historian and psychiatrist, and has two daughters, Sarah and Jane. Their home is in Los Angeles, California, where she currently spends about a third of her time. The other third of her time, she lives in Shaker Heights here in the area. So please, would you all join me in welcoming Dr. Deborah Gribbon, the interim director of the Cleveland Museum of Art.
So now, can you hear me? Good. Raise your hand if you can't, or wave them. But I am gratified to know that this is the first in the series, because then I feel that I'll establish the baseline and it'll only go up from there. Dr. Martin suggested that I talk informally about a few things that she thought might interest you, my background in terms of education and experience, which I underscore are two very different things. Challenges that I've faced, management issues in a museum, and so I'm happy to start off, but first I thought I would bring you a word from my sponsor. The Cleveland Museum of Art was founded in the early years of the 20th century. It's become, over the course of nearly a century, not only one of Cleveland's greatest cultural assets, but also one of the finest art museums in this country, and I think one would not be exaggerating to say even the world. Here you see the original building, which was built in 1916. I hope all of you have been there. It's a great neoclassical temple. Among the many goals that motivated those who founded the museum was the idea of creating something truly significant. Both aesthetically and in terms of civic value, hence the idea of the Grand Palace for the Arts. It also entailed the desire to create a collection that would be one of the greatest in the country, and the intention of making the museum free for all people forever. Hence today our admission is still free. And this is a not so fast, you know. We'll just go on. I was going to show you the newer side of the museum that was opened, built in the late 1960s and opened in 1970, the Breuer Building. But as Dr. Barnes pointed out, we have at this point about 46,000 works of art. We're still growing. The collection provides what you might describe as a selective survey of the visual arts, including antiquities. I show you an extraordinarily rare ancient Greek bronze. Bronze is almost never found because it was almost always melted down for usually armaments, but sometimes jewelry as well. This dates from the 5th century BC. Medieval objects. This is a cross, a processional cross, as its name indicates, would have been held at the opening of a procession. It was made in the 12th century in France. We also have terrific strengths in European paintings. This one by the Spanish artist, Zurbaran, as well as Japanese art, terrific strength there. This is an 18th century screen. Indian art. This isn't going to have quite the wow factor that I'd hoped when you see these when it's a little bit darker. This is a Shiva made in the 10th century. And we also have wildly inventive and a very luxurious decorative arts. This is one of the most extravagant pieces. It's a tureen, like a soup tureen, that was ever made in silver. And it was made in the 18th century. We have 19th century works. This is a canvas that we own by Vincent van Gogh. More modern work. This is a painting by the artist Jacob Lawrence, who died in 2003. And then Andy Warhol's Maryland times 100. We actually go on to the art of today as well. I just didn't happen to bring those samples. Now, as you may know, we are currently expanding the museum. And this shows you the overhead view where you see the original building that is in white. And we are now in the process of building around that. It will be finished in 2013, cost of over $200 million. And at the point that we open it, we expect the museum to be completely transformed. The collection is going to be reinstalled entirely, reinterpreted. We've made a major commitment to education. This shows you one of the older galleries in the old building, the 1916 building. Everything had to be pulled down to the studs, and because there had just not been the kind of maintenance required. This is another plan of the a rendering of when the building will be complete. And then this shows you the East Wing as it's being built. These galleries have actually been finished. They now have the 19th century and more modern collection in it. And you can see this is one of the more beautiful galleries that we have. It's the Rodin Gallery, named for the sculpture that is in it. And then this slide should show you a big hole, essentially, in the middle of the museum campus. You know, you see that the older building, the white building, is there. The more recent Breuer wing in the stripes to the right is there. But what's going to go in this space that's going to be excavated is this extraordinary atrium space, which is about the size of a football field and is going to be covered entirely in glass. So that we hope that's going to be a civic space where people from the area and from Cleveland come and enjoy the museum collections, but also just enjoy getting together and talking with each other and then going back and looking in the galleries again. So that's that. What I thought I would try to do is just talk about a few points, and then I really would like to take questions, and I know that some of you have classes to go to. But it occurred to me before talking about management issues that it might be helpful just to talk about what a museum director does. I'm not sure that's clear to everybody. I often find that people assume that I'm there when the museum's open, but not there when the museum's not open. And in fact, most of the work gets done when the museum is closed to visitors. The work of the museum in general, I guess, can be broken down into a variety of areas. And obviously, there will be more or less depending upon the size of the museum. I'd say the Cleveland Museum of Art, in terms of its collection, is, as I said, really one of the finest in the country. In terms of size, it's probably mid-size. But obviously, with the renovation, it will then be much larger. The art part of the work is acquiring works of art for each of the collections. Do that typically by buying them. Occasionally, people give you works of art, installing them in galleries, interpreting them, Those are the labels that you see, and hopefully they're occasionally you find them interesting enough to read. And now that museums are pulling themselves into at least the 20th century, we're also getting a little more savvy about technology and how to use different kinds of technology to help you look more closely and see things that you might not see if you were simply there on your own. We also mount special exhibitions, and by that I mean we bring in shows of works of art, usually borrowed from a number of other institutions, some as far away as Asia, and bring them together around a particular subject. Usually that has something to do with the collection that we have in-house, but sometimes it's in an area that we don't collect at all, in order to show the visitors and the people who live in the region a different view of art than they might not get unless they traveled pretty broadly. Then there's the financial side, and that is something that's become increasingly important in museums, as it has, I think, probably in every other nonprofit. There is the usual budgeting, fundraising, applying for grants, and also increasingly trying to generate revenue or earned income. So museums are paying closer attention to their restaurants and to their gift shops or bookstores. Some are renting out spaces as a way of earning revenue. There is a great deal of marketing that goes on. That's something I think that's particularly important, to tell you the truth, for the Cleveland Museum of Art. I think it has something of the reputation, probably left over from the days when it was a sort of temple of the arts, that it is remote and potentially of interest only to other people, whoever those other people are. And so we're very anxious to use marketing to let people know that we're there and that we have something of interest to offer really everybody, or at least it's worth giving it a try, and that best of all, we're free. And that's not always the case with museums, so it's something to be pleased about in your own community. There's a big component of customer service. We have at this point, not all of our galleries are reopened because we're still in the middle of construction, but we have we probably will expect 500,000, 600,000, sometimes 700,000 or 800,000 visitors a year. Those are people who need to figure out quickly how to get around, where the services are, where they can get a bite to eat, and we want to make sure that they're happy and that they feel comfortable. Now that, I should say right away, is a difference from the old museums. Old museums were pretty much set up that we've got the art, we know what we're doing, if you want to come, do that, but be on your best behavior, don't ask for much help from us, and behave yourself. Sometimes you're a builder. That's clearly what's been the case of the prior two directors at the Cleveland Museum of Art, and I'm overseeing that process as well. I worked previously at a museum in Los Angeles where, during the time that I was there, and it was a 12-year project, we had the largest single-stage building project in Los Angeles. It was built the building of the Getty Center, which comprised a study center and conservation and also a museum. And there we had about 1.3 million visitors a year. And that was a very big project and one where you learn a great deal about construction and managing construction. Now, depending upon the size of the museum, the various things that I just described, and there can be more, publications are often a element, technology is increasingly a division unto itself. You have large groups of people that are specialists in those areas, and it's the director's job to get all of those people working together. And I'll talk a little bit more about some of the management challenges in nonprofits and museums, but and also I think a little bit more about what people, their background is typically for museum work. Personally, I started out thinking that I was interested in art history, or this was actually fairly early on because long, long ago, when I was in high school, there was a art history course taught there, and that's pretty common now in terms of AP placement or some other schools, but it was very rare then. And I liked it. When I went to college, I took more art history courses, and I was pretty good at it. Not because I was particularly smart, but I was raised a Catholic. And so, at least in European art, I knew all the subject matter. I knew the saints were, I knew the martyrdoms. So that put me ahead of the game, and then I liked it even better. I did go to graduate school right away. That's something that I would recommend people waiting for a while and getting a little experience before they do, but I didn't. And I got a master's degree, as was described earlier, and then a PhD degree. And my field was, again, strictly art history. My specialty was 19th century French painting, drawing, printmaking, and photography. And that's not an unusual background for a museum director. Typically, the art, and appropriately, the art end of a museum trumps the other specialties. Increasingly, people, however, are going to business schools, so they have that degree as well. Or what is, I think, probably more common is taking a sort of a mid-career course in business that is typically designed for either people who work in nonprofits or sometimes people specifically who work in museums, because the old school training of just art history doesn't do very much to prepare you for management or financial issues, or sometimes I think much of anything. I had thought when I went to graduate school that I would probably teach, and that is what most people do when they get a PhD in art history. But I realized as I was doing it, and I was actually fortunate enough to go to a school that had a small museum, just as you have a gallery here, as part of the campus. And one of the things you could do as a graduate student was to teach undergraduates or other poor souls who came into the galleries. And I did that, and I really loved it. I really liked dealing with objects, not just slides, not the whole span of history of art, but what you could learn from an individual object or a group of objects that were hung together. And so that's why I decided to go into museum work. I certainly didn't intend to become a museum director, but it just, as it is with life, that was the way my career route went. I, in terms of experience, when I was still in graduate school, I think I took every internship possible in museums in Washington, D.C. My family lived in Washington, and so I could live with them for free because in those days, internships weren't paid at all. And it was a very good experience to see different kinds of museums, an American museum, a modern museum, one that was specifically based in 19th century American art. So I recommend that as something to gain experience. It's not always a financial possibility, but sometimes you can intern even for one night a week or one day a week. And then after that, I took a job while still in graduate school in Boston at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum, which is what they call a house museum. It was actually someone's house, Isabella Stewart Gardner's, as it happens. And she had a collection that she installed, and it had a staff of maybe 5 people. I was the first curator they had because it was unusual in that they weren't allowed to sell works of art. They had Mrs. Gardner's collection, and it stayed exactly as she had left it. On the other hand, because they hadn't had a curator, they had not done any research on the collections. So while I was there, we wrote catalogs. We cared for the collection in terms of conservation, something I didn't mention earlier, but which is a very important part of museum work, and generally managed, as they say, that small staff. I then went, after 6 years there, to Los Angeles. We intended to stay, as maybe many people do, in Los Angeles for about 2 years. And in the end, we stayed there for 20 years, my husband and I. The Getty was a terrific experience. It was a museum that was, it was founded by the oil magnate, J. Paul Getty, but it really was, it was initially occupied only the property that he had that was a retreat near Malibu, outside of Los Angeles. And it housed his own personal collection. And it really became a public museum, I think really largely because of a tax dodge. He would pay fewer taxes if it were open to the public for short periods of time. And it went on that way for some time, but at his death in 1976, he surprised everybody by leaving the bulk of his fortune to the museum. And at that point, it became probably the richest museum in the world. Interestingly enough, Cleveland is a museum that in its history has been very, very well endowed, unusually so for most museums. So that in a funny way, although the Getty at one time had an endowment of some $6 billion, in terms of buying power and collecting works of art, Cleveland was probably next in order. The other thing to say is, although there was a lot of money, there was nothing there. We actually built a new museum, a whole center, as I described it, and we really had to build a collection. So it was a very exciting time to be there. I left in 2004. I hadn't actually intended to retire, but a variety of things happened, and among them a family illness. So in 2005, I found myself, to certainly everybody else's surprise, and I guess to my own, tremendously enjoying being deeply lazy. And I was, you know, people always say, oh yeah, you must have been doing something. Well, actually, no, I really wasn't doing anything. I was cooking a lot and doing some photography and enjoying not having people call me all the time and having to be somewhere all the time. And that's really much, pretty much how I thought life would play out for me. I got a call last July from Michael Horvitz, one of the board members at the Cleveland Museum of Art, who told me that Timothy had just announced that he would be leaving, the current director, now former, and was going to Philadelphia. And Michael and I had discussed the possibility of a job for me at Cleveland some years before. And he said, you know, I think you ought to start working again. And that didn't seem right to me. But the more we talked and the more I heard about what was going on in Cleveland, I really couldn't resist it. So once again, I guess to my surprise, I got back in the game. I'm here only until they find a new director. The search is ongoing. It was begun in September. I would expect that by this coming September, there will be a permanent director, or at least a long-term director, in place. But in the meantime, it's really been a very interesting experience. And if you like, I can tell you a little bit more about that later. Challenges. Well, I'm sorry to say that sexism has been something of a challenge. I hope that's less so today. My favorite story is when I started, I'd gone to an all-women's college, and so when I went to graduate school, I was one of only two women in the class, and I was really surprised because I knew lots of people that were interested in going into art history. And so I asked a professor what the deal was. Did they just not get many applications, or... And he was, you know, this was in the late 1960s, so there was a lot of political activism, and he was a very famous liberal. And he had absolutely no compunction of saying to me, well, you know, we can't let women, we can't let people in simply on the basis of merit, because if we did, the class would be overwhelmingly female. And So, you know, there was that attitude. And I say that not because I think there are other people who then and now have probably more serious strikes, as it were, against them. I really only point that out to illustrate that I think you'll probably always find that there's somebody who thinks that you shouldn't or can't do what you, in fact, want to do and probably can do. So don't let that get in your way. In a nonprofit, I think one of the challenges is that the bottom line isn't exactly clear. It certainly is. It's true. You have to come in on budget. And that's a very important thing. You have to raise a certain amount of money. But what I mean by that is the measure of success isn't quite so clear as it is, I imagine, in the for-profit world, both for individual performance and for the performance of the institution. So are you a success if all of your exhibitions are extremely scholarly, but nobody walks in the door? Are you a success if you have a huge collection, but never take the time or the effort to interpret it or explain it to people? Are you a success if you stay in the museum and just wait for people to come to you? In terms of personal performance, it's not just who contributes the most to the bottom line. So I think that's something that's a challenge in managing, and it requires you, I think, to be much clearer about what the priorities are and what the goals are, and something of a cheerleader for bringing people along with you. And in a museum, I have to say that I think probably one of the challenges, and this is hard to describe until you get there and then you know it, that you are managing very different people. The curators who have spent their lives studying art history and with works of art are very different from the financial people who maintain the budgets, are very different from the conservators who are charged with preserving the collection. They're typically, they have a very strong scientific background as well as artistic background. Their view of, and they're correct, ultimately the way you protect a work of art is to keep it in a black box or a black room. But obviously the museum is in the business of showing works of art, and so there are lots of discussions about light levels and humidity and how long something can be on view. So it is a challenge to get all of those people working together and to bring the best out in all of them. And I think at base, that's really what a director does in a museum. I think if a director thinks that they are primarily a curator, the person who selects the art and buys it and hangs it, I suspect that they're leaving something undone, because I think it's what only the director can provide is direction, after all. Establishing priorities and making sure that people work together to get there. So I have little tidbits of advice, but if my daughters were here, they would tell me not to give that. So I thought maybe, I mean, I'd be very, very happy to answer questions or talk about something else. There is. It's a painting by Monet, Claude Monet, and it's an image. I'm sorry, I don't have an image of it. It's a woman who's his wife, as it happens, or the woman who would become his wife, standing outside a window, and it's a winter scene. It was painted very early in his career. I'm particularly interested in it because at this moment, this was painted around 1866, I think, 67, French artists were still primarily interested in painting human beings. Now, more conservative artists painted figures that were religious figures or heroic historical figures. More modern artists tended to paint people from everyday life. But you still, to be a very ambitious painter, you wanted to do a big picture of human beings. Big because all these pictures were shown in enormous art exhibitions called the Salon, where literally thousands of things would be shown, because it was really, you know, it was akin to going to the movies. Everybody would go and look at them, usually to make fun of things, sometimes to admire things. And if your work was bigger, it stood out and it got hung lower. And so Monet, who becomes an impressionist, and that's what he's famous for, had been killing himself trying to get a large-scale modern figure painting. And he posed these figures outdoors. And he couldn't do it. It was cumbersome because it was a really big canvas, and working outdoors is very cumbersome. So he had no money at this point, and he and his mistress moved outside of Paris, and he made a fairly small-scale picture. He must have done it very quickly. It's almost all gray, you think, until you look at it, and the gray is composed of blue and white and beige and little spots of green. But the figure who's walking by in the background is wearing a red cape. But it's all painted in what we would soon learn was the so-called impressionist style. And the point here was he was no longer focusing on the figure per se. What he wanted to convey to people who were looking at that picture was the impression of, the sense that one would have of a fleeting moment. It became about time. So it's this woman who walks by, it's as if you caught her out of the corner of your eye, and then she's obviously going to move on. Next summer he goes out, he starts painting with Renoir, starts to paint landscapes, where that kind of thing is much easier to do, or it's a more appropriate subject for that. And that starts Impressionism. So that was a longer answer, I guess, than you expected for my favorite. But I wish I had all the time in the world to spend in the galleries, but unfortunately that's one of the things that goes pretty quickly when you start working in an office. No, I wasn't there at the time, and they haven't been able to collect it, and they don't know what happened to it. I went to the Getty in 84. I think it took place around 86 or so. And thieves came in, and they cut, I mean, really painful to think about, they cut canvases out of their frames, because it's much easier to roll up a canvas and take it out the door than to take a big frame. And they stole, I can't remember now, but a small Manet, a Renoir, Rembrandt, too, and some other paintings as well. And I think there was always a suspicion that it was, well, there are many suspicions, but I think people, there was a ransom offered, a sizable amount of money, and I think people always assumed that this is sort of romantic notion that someone had commissioned the theft and who lived in some exotic place and then would look at these things for their own delectation without anyone knowing where they were. But I think that's actually probably not true. I'm not sure people know of it. It's never been discovered a case like that. And I think what's more likely happened is someone who wasn't a very experienced thieves took them. I think they didn't realize how hard it would be to unload them. And I'm sorry to say they either destroyed them or hid them. And I hope the latter, but they haven't been found. As it happens, I was working at the Getty then, and they have a very famous painting conservation department. And our conservators went to Boston right away to take the stretchers. You stretch canvas over a wooden frame, and what the thieves had done is cut all around that stretcher. And so there were still remnants of canvas left. So the Getty has those in case they can ever be matched up again with the whole painting. It was a very sad thing. Oh, shame on you. Does everybody know what the May Show is? The May Show was an enormously successful event, which I don't think took place every year. Am I right about that? If it didn't take place every year, it was regularly, every 2 years. And for a while, it may have been every year. And it was a juried show, I think, and it was open to the public. And Cleveland has some wonderful local artists, not just now, which is the case, but also in the past. And people would exhibit works there, and there would be a prize. And people adored the May Show. And many years ago, it was discontinued. And I laugh because I don't think I've ever been out of the museum when someone hasn't asked me that question. It's so beloved. And of course, then I go back, what do I know? And I say to the people, well, why don't you do the May Show again? And I think it is something they're considering. It was an enormous undertaking, in fact, in terms of organization and getting bigger and bigger. So it would be nice to find something perhaps a little less frequently and perhaps a little bit more manageable, but it is under consideration. You know what, it's interesting because what is unique in Cleveland is how long the early directors stayed. And indeed, people were very unhappy when Timothy left, or sad to see him go, I should say. And he was a very great director, so I understand that. But someone put it into perspective for me because until this point, Cleveland had never had a director that left the museum. They had either, to take another job, they'd either resigned, or unfortunately, in one case, the man died. So it's very unusual to have that kind of longevity. And with every museum also now, it's becoming much more common for people to be moving around. But I have to think it is a testament to Cleveland that to me, as an outsider, it just seems like a community that people, they certainly care about the museum, they typically know about it, they're proud of it, even if they may not visit it. I think it speaks well of the community that had those long runs.
Have you applied for the job?
No, I took the job with the understanding that I was not a candidate for the long-term job. My husband is wed to me and to Los Angeles. And I think they need somebody who's younger than I am and full of energy. But I wish I could stay. I wish I could stay. You're absolutely right. There's a sad relationship between art and war, and really it was a very common thing for art, among other things, to be taken as trophies of war, and hence you have a variety of monuments in Paris, for example, that are not French-made. And World War II was a particularly grievous example. And of all the things that were undoubtedly stolen, I'm sorry to say that I think a very small percentage has been recovered. And it's a very complicated situation. In some cases, one thing that's hard to understand, or not hard to understand, but people may not realize, is that works of art often do not have a very clear history of ownership. Paintings often do, if it's by by Rembrandt or Titian. But if it's a drawing, no matter how great the artist, they're usually not cataloged in the same way. Things obviously were not, well, not obviously, but they weren't always photographed. And so from a catalog description, you know, watercolor by Monet, landscape, it's very hard to identify that. Another thing is that the works were widely dispersed, not just to individuals, but also countries. So Russia, for example, took a lot of things from Germany and kept it. And various other Eastern European countries are in that same situation, and it's hard to sort out ownership issues. And then there are museums that are often in America, because they were museums, many European museums had very fine collections from, say, the 19th century. Whereas the 20th century, late 19th and 20th century, was the real building moment for collections. And so many works of art came on the market in the 1950s and even 60s, and it turned out to have been looted during the war. Now, efforts have been made. There's a database that lists all the objects that are known to have been looted that can be identified, so that when you try to acquire a work of art and it has what they call a gap in its provenance or its history, you don't know where it was, say, from 1938, 40, you better start thinking about where it might have been if you're a museum and you're responsible. But you can go to that database and see if it's listed there. But not everything is listed, so there are still claims that are brought, and you do your best to sort through the evidence. I know that some of the difficulties that were discovered is that the looting was typically not by the occupying troops. And furthermore, it was a little uncertain once they began looking through storerooms as to when actually some of the objects had disappeared. So the records weren't as clear as they might have been. It was a very messy situation. And I just don't have more information on that. It's still pretty difficult, I think, to get information about it. I know the British Museum was very, very active in sending people over right away to try to help them do an assessment of what they had and hence what might be missing. Well, typically if a museum has an object that they, you know, museums research objects all the time. And if the research into the history of a particular object leads one to believe that it might have been stolen under any circumstance, then you typically try to find out who its rightful owner is and if you can restore it. And another route is the opposite route, where someone thinks that you have something that you that was stolen from them, but not by the museum, but by someone maybe three ways back. In other words, sold it to someone who perhaps gave it to the museum. And so the best you can do is publish your collections so that people know what you have, and if they're looking for something, they have a chance of finding it. I wish. I haven't discovered him, if that's the case. No, very few museums do that now. In the 19th century, 19th century and early 20th century, museums very typically supported excavation campaigns. And they usually did that with the cooperation of the country where they were doing the excavation, and they agreed to an arrangement where the museum that was excavating could take some of the works of art, and obviously the home country would as well. But I should say that wasn't always the case. Sometimes both, you know, French, English, Germans, you name it, Americans, organized archaeological digs, and their view was if they found it, they took it. But often they were done as a cooperative venture. But that's less the case now, because those countries tend to feel very strongly, much more strongly these days, that the work that is found in the ground, whether their ancestors created it or not, but if it was in their ground, they own it, and they don't want it going anywhere. Well, those are really interesting questions. The trend so far, although, as is often the case, you're usually about a year behind in terms of your numbers, is that museum attendance is very, very strong, surprisingly strong, really. I suspect that that may decrease, particularly at museums that charge admission or suggest an admission price, because it's getting very high. I think the other question you had was, are they growing? Or I think an interesting phenomenon is that at a certain point, maybe the last quarter of the last century, museums proliferated. And it developed that every city, every small town, every kind of art or subject of interest, history, historical societies, they just sprung up everywhere. And I think that that was a time of expansion everywhere. And I'm afraid now there's probably going to be a little bit of a shrinking there, because and it may be not that institutions go out of business, but they may form partnerships. And because I think they're just, at the moment anyway, and it probably was unrealistic. There just isn't the population or the resources to support that kind of proliferation. There was also a huge building boom. And some of those, I think, are very good examples. Some of them, I think people began to develop the concept of, you know, if you build it, they will come. And I personally think that's a mistake. I think the Frank Gehry's building in Bilbao, and frankly the Getty to some degree, started that idea that if you had a star architect build an extraordinary building, that is what would draw visitors, because that's, of course, the holy grail, to have more and more and more visitors. But I think it's pretty clear that a building in itself doesn't, or to the degree that it draws visitors, it eventually is a limited number of visitors, and what counts is what you offer them when they get there. No, I wasn't actually. There's a garden at the Getty Museum, which was the commission was awarded to a conceptual artist, Bob Irwin, and there was a famous argument between the architect, Richard Meyer, who saw everything in a grid, and Bob Irwin, who saw everything as a free-flowing, shall we say. I really did all my work on the museum building, but not the garden. But it was interesting to watch. We have recently, with partners, renovated the Fine Arts Garden, which is just in front of the museum, and have done some improvements around the lagoon as well, which looks, I should tell you, spectacular right now because of all the trees are coming out. And then we will have sculpture and paths and places to sit at various points around the museum. So it will be, I think, a really beautiful setting, not just a beautiful building. Well, I certainly hope it will increase the interest in the art, and the museum will be better for it by having more people come and different kinds of people come. We do charge, I don't want to be cute with you, we do charge for some temporary exhibitions, but we also have some of them that are free. But our goal is to, you know, really the best way to visit the museum is to go for a half hour or an hour, see something, and then before you get tired, have a cup of coffee or leave and then come back. And so I really do feel that museums hold collections in trust for the public, and so they should be as available to the public as possible. Well, I'm an optimist, so I think that people will continue to come, and even more of them will. I truly think that it's the kind of experience that if you come, you'll like it, and I think you'll be back. So hopefully this will be the difficult times we're having now, and the advantage of having something be free will bring people that might not have come otherwise, but they'll end up liking it so much that they'll continue to come even when they have more disposable income. Maybe they'll give money to us. The Cleveland Museum had not been, and this is not unusual, this is typical in museums, not been, well, let me start out by saying, as I think I mentioned earlier, visitors and their interests and the way they're treated are increasingly important to museums. But it is not unusual that museums have had very, very little information about visitors. So one of the things that we're doing is trying to get more information about the people that come, what they like, what they don't like. We are also doing evaluations or visitor, I would say non-visitor surveys, going to places like a mall or a movie theater, and if people are willing to talk to our evaluators, asking them, had they considered going to a museum? Do they ever go to a museum? If not, why not? If so, what would, if they had any interest, what would draw them? So that's one element, which is just trying to get a baseline so that we can get a better sense of how we're doing as we go forward. The other thing was that it's very difficult. Temporary exhibitions, and one of the reasons you charge for them is that they're extremely expensive. The shipping is almost always what does it to you. The insurance and the shipping of works of art is very, very expensive. And it's very hard to tell beforehand how many people are likely to come to the museum to see the show. And if you are charging, what they'd be willing to pay. So now we are doing, again, a sort of interventions with people or stopping people in a systematic way and asking them if they, for example, we had a Gauguin show in the summer when I first arrived, and everyone expected a certain amount of attendance because we considered in-house Gauguin to be a sort of household name. So we actually went out and tested that, and it turns out that I was surprised. Maybe 65% or 75% of the people that we asked had no idea who Paul Gauguin was. So that gave us a really important bit of information as to how many people we could expect, and also absolutely keyed into what our marketing campaign would be. So we played on the idea that people might not have any idea who this artist was, and so we tried to develop teasers that would give you bits of information about him, because he was, after all, a pretty colorful character, not just his art, but he himself, so that that might pique people's interest and they would come. So those are the kinds of things, and they continue to do that with every show. Most museums in the United States still charge admission. There is a trend to drop admission charges, but most of them still do. Actually, European museums also, most of them charge admission. The National Gallery in London some time ago made a big stir by saying that they weren't going to charge admission, and I think now many of the English national museums do not charge admission. The museum is very interesting to me. Museums in the United States and Europe in general are very, very different, because the European museum system is almost entirely national. So it is run by the state, it's centralized. You don't have the phenomenon of private museums or museums supported by a city. The only national museum we have, well, really is the National Gallery of Art. The Smithsonian, I suppose, is as well. So that's a big difference. But nevertheless, across the board, they're all charging admission. I think technology has a lot to offer museums, but I do think it's largely in terms of bringing people into the museum and providing tools for research, because I personally believe that the value of a museum is that you can go and see the real thing, and with a work of art, the real thing is different. There isn't any way of, as you say, recreating its sort of tangible qualities. But I think in terms of websites and also in terms of research possibilities, I think it has tremendous opportunities. The other thing that you can do that's very difficult is to works of art. Museums seem like such strange places because you have these works of art that each came from, many of which came from different kinds of contexts, and it's very difficult to recreate that context. But you can use technology, either having, say, some kind of computer system that is available somewhere in the museum, or small things that you can carry with you, which I'm sure we'll have relatively soon, or stations nearby the galleries, where you could see lots of different things, what an altarpiece in a Renaissance church would look like, so that you understand that it was really almost a piece of architecture built into this elaborate frame. How you make a bronze sculpture, so you understand how incredibly difficult it is, just in a physical sense, that kind of thing. And museums should make better use of that, because otherwise it can be very obscure. It's a very important distinction among those museums, but I don't think the management of it is very different. But the kinds of programs that you do and your goals might differ. And indeed, I think Cleveland is so fortunate to have really have what we think of as repeat visitors. I mean, that's what every museum is dying for, someone who just doesn't come because they're in town and they walk through the galleries and that's that, and then they never come again. But people who think of it as their museum and their collection, that's a wonderful resource. Yes, it is. It's very hard. Often board members have, one thing that museums are trying to do is to make sure that their board has some diversity of all kinds, you know, people of different ages, men, women, people of color, so that it isn't just a small group of people deciding what is going to be for everybody else. In terms of trying to become visitor-centric, it's a challenge because there is, at base, some level of, after all, we are, as it were, the experts. You know, I mean, we do know certain things, and so it would be, I think, a mistake to simply do whatever someone out in the community told you to do. On the other hand, I think the experts have for too long felt that there was only one way of interpreting something or talking about something, and that's a big mistake, because there are lots of different ways of coming at something, and our job is to make sure that as many of those ways are available as possible to different people. Well, you've been very kind to put up with me, and I've enjoyed your questions. Thank you.